Hi, I'm Shashank Bhargav, and you're listening to Three Things, the Indian Express news show. In this episode, we talk about a vaccine scam running in Mumbai. We will also take a quick look at the latest comments made by RSS Chief Mohan Bhagwat. But first, we talk about Uttarakhand. On Sunday, Pushkar Singh Dhami of the BJP was sworn in as the new Chief Minister of Uttarakhand. This happened after Tirath Singh Rawat resigned from his post on Friday. Dhami has now become the third chief minister to be appointed in the last 4 months in the state. Just to set the timeline straight, first, Trivendra Singh Rawat, who had been the chief minister of the state for nearly 4 years, resigned from his post back in March. And then a day after that, BJP picked Lok Sabha MP Tirath Singh Rawat for the post. This move had come as a surprise to many because he was not one of the probables that the party had been considering. Now, Tirath Singh Rawat was not a member of the state legislature in Uttarakhand, which one needs to be to hold the post of the chief minister. If, for example, one isn't elected an MLA within 6 months of being appointed, then it could lead to a constitutional crisis. And it had already been nearly 4 months since Rawat was appointed. So this appears to be the reason why the BJP has now replaced Tirath Singh Rawat with Pushkar Singh Dhami. Though when we spoke to Liz Matthew, who reports on the BJP for the newspaper, she said that the potential constitutional crisis was not the only reason this happened, and that this replacement speaks to the larger infighting going on within the BJP. And to explain that, she started by talking about the appointment of Tirath Singh Rawat.
As we know, Tirath Singh Rawat was appointed as the chief minister or handpicked by the central leadership in March 2021 to replace Trivendra Singh Rawat, who had drawn resentment or reservations from the Sangh as well as the many factional leaders in the BJP's Uttarakhand unit. The some measures he had taken, the both the Sangh or the leaders could not accept. So Trivendra Singh Rawat was replaced by Tirath Singh Rawat. At that time, BJP was busy with Bengal elections and there were 5 other state elections also. That was the time BJP just looked at the factional equations or power equations in the state to pick one. So Tirath Singh Rawat was one of the least harmful or like more accepted among other all the units, or somebody whose appointment would not create further troubles in the state unit. That was the main reason for the party leadership to pick up Tirath Singh Rawat, who was an Lok Sabha MP that time.
But she says that picking Tirath Singh Rawat to be the chief minister proved to be a mistake by the BJP. During his short tenure, he couldn't really prove himself to be a fresh face. Plus, he made a lot of controversial statements that even people within the BJP criticized. Like in an event, he said that Prime Minister Narendra Modi will be admired like Lord Ram and Krishna in the future. And in another speech, he claimed that America had enslaved India for 200 years. Also, during a workshop organized by the State Commission for Protection of Children's Rights, he said that women wearing ripped jeans send a wrong message to society and children.
Husband, कहाँ है? जीएनयू में प्रोफेसर है. तुम क्या करती हो? मैं एनजीओ चलाती हूँ. एनजीओ चलाती है? घुटने फटे दिखते हैं, समाज के बीच में जाती हो, बच्चे साथ में हैं, क्या संस्कार हो?
Liz says that Uttarakhand goes to elections next year, but the BJP also had the option to hold by-elections before that, if it actually thought Tirath Singh Rawat could win. But that was not the case. In fact, the party didn't even approach the election commission regarding it because of this reason.
An election commission sources have said that they were ready to hold a by-election if the party and the government wanted. So a defeat in state election, that also in Uttarakhand, which is neighboring Uttar Pradesh, would send a bad signal for BJP, which has been hoping to re-elect in Uttar Pradesh also, which is politically very crucial state. The leadership could not afford that. They did not want to take that risk. These are the other reasons for party to go for another person who is a sitting MLA to be the face of the party to go for election in early 2022.
This sitting MLA was, of course, Pushkar Singh Dhami, who at 45 is also the youngest chief minister of the state. Liz explains the reason why he was chosen.
He's a sitting MLA, that is the main reason. And also, he's the one from whom the leadership could get some kind of consensus among the other leaders who are veterans and tall leaders and who are aspirants for the post. As we know, the party leadership wanted to send Anil Baloni to Uttarakhand to lead the election. But Anil Baloni is being a Rajya Sabha MP. Again, they allowed to face election. That was one reason. Again, Satpal Maharaj, who originally a congressman who had joined BJP, they couldn't trust him also. So basically, the power equation, the factional issues in the party and the internal strife and the overall situation after COVID, because the BJP government in Uttarakhand, as like the other state governments, had faced a lot of flak for handling the COVID situation. And if you talk to MLAs and party leaders in the state, they would say that there is not much for the party or the party-led government to project as an achievement during the last 4.5 years. So this was also, so they wanted a new face, a young face, and who's more accepted among all the factions and all the groups.
So that is how Pushkar Singh Dhami got to be the new chief minister of the state. And Liz says that his selection and the infighting within the BJP in the state has come at a time when the party has been facing a whole host of other issues.
See, all these, the state issues have come up at a time when the central leadership of the BJP as well as the center government have come under flak for its handling of the COVID situation during the second surge. We have seen how in social media or even the international media, critics have come out against the way the government handled the issue, especially during the peak of second surge. And the electoral defeat in West Bengal, electoral defeat in other states other than Assam, have created some kind of chinks in the armor. And there was kind of infallibility for this government and the prime minister, which was broken. So this has kind of given a rise to, or kind of more fillip to, the people who have been disenchanted, disillusioned with the performance or the functioning of the state leaders in the respective state.
In this regard, she gives the example of Uttar Pradesh and the ambitions of Keshav Prasad Maurya. He was the BJP state unit president and he had led the party during the 2017 elections.
He was a major reason for party gained a massive support among the non-Yadav OBC group. Keshav Prasad Maurya was the reason for that. And he had that stint in VHP. He had that Hindutva-friendly face. This all helped BJP to consolidate the Hindu vote and also non-Yadav OBC vote, which played a crucial role in party's splendid victory in 2017. And Keshav Prasad Maurya obviously expected he would be one of the contenders. He was one of the contenders for the top post. And obviously the central leadership chose Yogi Adityanath.
This decision left Keshav Prasad Maurya frustrated, though he continued to work within the party. And now, as elections are near, many feel that he should be one of the contenders for the post of the chief minister. And right now, the BJP has to deal with many such people within the party who have personal ambitions like Keshav Prasad Maurya, and who, like Liz says, are disenchanted with the leadership. This is the case in UP, in Madhya Pradesh, in Tripura, and even in Rajasthan, where BJP is not in power right now.
Where Vasundhara Raje continues to call the shot when it comes to the state unit. But the official faction, so-called official faction, including the LOP Gulab Chand Kataria and others, the center leadership also made it very clear that they do not want Vasundhara to continue. But Vasundhara is still continue to be the strongest leader of BJP, which the central leadership and the official faction there are not accepting. So again, it is personal ambition of a certain leader. See, BJP is, unlike the Congress, is considered to be a disciplined party. But obviously, we are seeing that when it comes to power, this kind of ambitions and also disappointment with the personality or the way they are running things, the way they are functioning, the chief minister or the state leadership, this creates a lot of differences among other leaders who are also like have their own contribution to the party. So when there was a perfect time for them, when you are weak, when the leadership is in a crisis, they think that this is the right time to come up and seek or demand for their share of pie.
She says that this is also the problem in Gujarat. But there, she says, everyone knows that the elections will take place under the leadership of Narendra Modi and Amit Shah.
So even if a few leaders fight with each other, it doesn't make much difference for the parties, the state unit and the cadre. But other state, it is not like that. So I think BJP is facing that a crisis, 7 years in power, facing after a slew of defeats and some electoral victories. But this is a crisis time, and that peak is over, it looks like. So the state units and their aspirations of leaders and ambitions of leaders are creating wedges.
Right now, the problem with the BJP appears to be that all decisions come from the center, and everyone else in other states are expected to abide by it. But Liz says that this was not always the case. There was a time when it had strong local leaders.
Like Vasundhara Raja in Rajasthan, Raman Singh in Chhattisgarh, Shivraj Singh Chauhan in Madhya Pradesh, and B.S. Yediyurappa in Karnataka. All these satraps were there. They had their own clout and they had their way. But since 2014, since both Narendra Modi and Amit Shah took over the party reins or took over the control of the party, they started sending leaders from the center. Like, for example, in Manohar Lal Khattar, a non-Jat in Haryana, a non-Maratha Devendra Fadnavis in Maharashtra, a non-tribal Raghubar Das in Jharkhand. So basically, they were all choice or hand-picked by the center. So recently, in an interview with the Indian Express, Amit Shah has admitted it was an experiment they wanted to do to break the caste barriers. And it was successful to an extent, but it had its own setbacks. And they are trying to deal with that. So he has admitted it had its own share of failures also. So this, even Uttarakhand is the perfect example. Trivendra Singh Rawat also was handpicked by the center. And he was sent, and there was issues after issues. Then they had to pick another leader, which also had proved to be wrong. Now, they say that they have gone by the MLA's version also. So now let's see, like only like 8-9 months left for the election. So this central leadership's over control. Some people criticize that as a reason for this kind of increasing troubles in the state unit. But I think it is anyway bound to happen because party is not one machine or something. Party is with the people. So obviously there are people with ambitions, people with different choices, and people with different style of functioning. So these are things bound to happen. And BJP is a party which so far they haven't shown any kind of its leadership, haven't shown any kind of complacency in it. So they are taking these issues seriously. They are dealing with them. They are holding discussions. They are trying to listen to the grievances of others and they are trying to solve the issue. Whether they will be able to this exercise, which the party central leadership is engaged in for some time, whether that will yield results, we'll have to see.
And next we talk about a vaccine scam. According to the Mumbai police, over 2,700 people have fallen prey to fake vaccination drives in the city. In at least 12 such vaccination drives, people were given saline water instead of an actual COVID-19 dose. The main person behind the gang operating the scam is said to be Mahendra Pratap Singh. And his first victims were the employees of a particular branch of Bank of Baroda in Mumbai. In this segment, Indian Express's Tabassum Barnagarwala joins us to talk about this scam and how it started. So Tabassum, could you first talk about how the employees of this particular branch of Bank of Baroda first got to know about this vaccination drive, which later turned out to be a scam?
See, so basically, one thing that we need to understand is that people are not able to get vaccines easily. And because the access is difficult, most of them have to book slots online. The eagerness for vaccine and the enthusiasm is so much that they're ready to go for different ways of getting vaccinated. So they will trust whoever offers to give vaccine. So that is what all the accused have played on, the factor that people are extremely eager to get vaccines. In case of Bank of Baroda, there were around 7 employees out of the 14 in that branch office of Malad who had got infected last year. And the remaining were a little panicky about the fact that they could get infected, because we had started seeing that there was a lot of crowd gathering in banks whenever the restrictions were getting lifted. Also, bank officials were not considered frontline workers. So that was one concern that they had. In April, there was an account holder who was attached with the bank since 2013. His name is Mahendra Pratap Singh. He's one of the main accused and the mastermind of the whole vaccine scam. He reached out to the branch manager and he offered that because he's in the medical circles, he knows hospitals and he could arrange vaccination for them. So in April, the first vaccination drive was arranged in a hospital called Shivam Hospital in Malad, where they were administered genuine vaccines. This was back in April. Last month in May, the bank again reached out to Singh, hoping that he would be able to arrange for a second dose for all the employees and their family members. So that is when he actually conned them. He said that we'll come to the branch office. I'll come with two people who will vaccinate the entire staff and their family. And we'll note down your Aadhaar card details and names. And we will provide vaccination certificates later.
So this was the fake vaccination drive.
This was the fake vaccination drive that the police suspects they actually used saline water in the vials instead of actual vaccines. So all the 40 employees got vaccinated. They waited for their certificates to come and they waited for actually several days. Because there was a trust factor with this account holder, he was a long-term account holder, they knew him well. They did not actually suspect anything at all. Until one day, there was one employee who received a WhatsApp forward of a news item where a vaccination scam has been busted. The details were given and the name of Mahendra Pratap Singh was mentioned as one of the accused who has been arrested. That is when they realized that maybe we were also fooled. They reached out to the local police station and the police station registered an FIR and they have recorded statements of all the employees. And the bank officials have now understood that the second dose that we were given was actually saline water. It was not actual vaccine. And they have still not received their certificates. So this is one of the first drives which the whole group gang of accused conducted, apart from the others that they then eventually went on to a scam.
And how much did these employees of Bank of Baroda end up paying for these vaccine shots?
So they actually paid 800 rupees per shot. See, so when these accused started the vaccination drive, they were charging around 800 to 900. And then slowly they improved their execution style. They started approaching more housing societies and corporate offices. Like Bank of Baroda just had 40 employees who were vaccinated. They slowly went on to vaccinate 400 to 500 people in a corporate office and in a residential society. And they started increasing their rates to 1200 rupees per dose. So across the various vaccination drives that they've conducted, there are around 12 so far that the police has found. More than 26 lakh rupees has been earned through these vaccination drives by the group of accused.
And in the case of Bank of Baroda, the first vaccine shot that these guys got was at the Shivam Hospital, where they were supposedly given an actual vaccine dose. So how is the Shivam Hospital involved in this scam?
Yes, so the BMC has sealed the hospital earlier this week because they found violations under the Bombay Nursing Home Act. The owners of the hospital, Dr. Shivraj Pataria, and his wife is a pharmacist. Her name is Neeta Pataria. So along with Mahendra Pratap Singh and another dentist, called Dr. Manish Tripathi. These four are the main accused who have basically then roped in other people into the gang and fooled people. The Patarias played a very crucial role in this whole process. In March and April, they had received vaccine vials from the government. So back then, private hospitals were allowed to buy doses from the government and administer those doses at a cost of 250 rupees per dose. So in March and April, whatever vials they received, more than 23,000 doses that this hospital received, they preserved the empty vials of vaccine instead of disposing it off as per norms. And these were the vials which were later supplied for refilling with saline water and then using it to administer in various drives.
Okay, so the Patarias are the owners of the Shivam Hospital and Mahinder Singh Patab is supposed to be at the heart of this entire scam, the person who got the Bank of Baroda employees involved. But apart from these three, you mentioned Dr. Manish Tripathi. How did he get involved in this?
So Dr. Manish Tripathi is basically a person who runs a coaching institute for medical students and for engineering students, and he offers placement opportunities to them. He was operating from a rented space in Shivam Hospital. So that is how he came to know about the Patarias. And when they roped him in, he was the one who took charge of filling the vials with saline water. He also provided manpower. Dr. Tripathi had few of his students who were extremely poor. So he promised them that if they administer vaccines, he will be providing them rupees 250 per drive. So for a mere 2 to 3,000 rupees that these kids earn, the kids are 19 to 20 year old. They have actually been listed as accused in the whole scam. Out of the three, two did not even know that they were administering fake vaccines. And slowly, slowly, the gang started growing as they required more resources. So they reached out to Kokilabain Hospital's marketing executive, who's a friend of Mahendra Pratap Singh. And they just asked him to give impression to all the housing societies and corporate offices that he represents Kokilabain Hospital. So most of these drives which were conducted were actually conducted by giving impression that Kokilabain Hospital is the main organizer and they are conducting the drive. In reality, Kokilabain Hospital was not aware that their marketing executive is involved in these activities. He did not even have access to the vaccination program of the hospital. But that name itself was enough to generate trust in the people that the vaccine which will come to us will be genuine. Another issue that we've seen in this whole process is that there are norms which have been laid down. Corporate offices and private societies, when they're having a private vaccination camp, they're supposed to sign a memorandum of understanding with the hospital which is going to organize the drive. And they're supposed to inform the local corporation, in this case, the BMC. But in all the drives that the police has so far found, none of the private societies or corporate offices actually registered with the BMC or signed an MOU. Most of them are claiming that they did not know the procedure and they just blindly trusted the organizers. And these organizers who are the accused actually used to reach out acquaintances to organize drives. So they are not reaching out to strangers. They are reaching out to people who are in their known circles and they are scamming those people through this whole network. We came across five cases where Rajesh Pandey actually reached out to patients who were previously admitted in Kokilabain Hospital and offered them vaccination. So that is how he reached out to people and he fooled them. In one case, we found that there were two employees who had been fired from a travel agency and they had been roped in by Mahendra Pratap Singh. And what they did was they used to reach out people in their database who had booked tickets with them in the past. And they used to reach out and ask them whether you're interested in vaccination or not. So that is how that group actually reached out to people.
So Shivam Hospital has been sealed by the police, but what action has been taken by these other individuals that were involved in the scam?
So there are various sections that the police has applied in these cases. The most common section is under the IPC 420, which is cheating. They've also applied few sections for culpable homicide and for causing injury. Because keeping the fact in mind that the vaccine could actually have been spurious and could have actually had side effects on the people who were administered with it. So there are a series of sections that the police has filed and there are different sections for each case. And each case is being individually investigated. There are at least 12 FIRs which have been filed so far.
And now, what are the kind of things that the police and the officials say that people should be on the lookout for so that they don't fall prey to such scams?
Now that this particular vaccine scam has been busted open, there are few series of measures that the BMC has taken, at least for Mumbai. So they have informed all the housing societies that if you're organizing a drive, you're at least supposed to inform the BMC or the local police 3 days before the camp is conducted so that a check could be done by the local authorities whether the whole drive is genuine or not. Second, it is compulsory for hospitals to sign an MOU and to inform BMC that they're holding a drive on this particular date in this particular location. So these two clauses have been made mandatory. Apart from that, housing societies have been told that if they're organizing a vaccination drive, they have to give all details, put that on a notice board in the society so that everybody has access to that information and they know who is going to come for vaccination and what is going to be the procedure. Also, there are a few things that people should always take note of while they are coming for private vaccination drives. There's always going to be a COVID portal on which their details will be entered, their name or identification proof number, and they will receive a message immediately after their vaccine shot. So in these drives, what the scamsters did was they told the people that you will receive your vaccination certificates after a few days. But in reality, how the system of government of India works will provide you a message immediately and a vaccine certificate almost within 24 hours of your jab. So if those things are not happening, people should understand and be aware that there's something wrong which is going on. In all these drives, these people actually noted down names and Aadhaar numbers. They did not use a laptop and they did not feed these details on COVID portal.
And in the end, we talk about the latest comments made by RSS Chief Mohan Bhagwat. Yesterday at an event organized by the Muslim Rashtra Manch, Bhagwat urged Muslims not to get trapped in the cycle of fear that Islam is in danger in India. while adding that people can't be differentiated on how they worship.
उन तथागतित अल्पसंख्यकों के मन में ये डर भरा गया है कि संघ वाले तुमको खा जाएंगे. दूसरा एक डर लगता है कि हिंदू मेजॉरिटी देश में आप रहोगे तो आपका इस्लाम चला जाएगा. ये भी बताया जाता है. अन्य किसी देश में ऐसा होता होगा, मेजॉरिटी माइनॉरिटी होगा. हमारे यहां ऐसा नहीं है. हमारे यहां जो जो आया है वो आज भी मौजूद है.
During the speech, he also said that those engaging in lynching are against Hindutva, but was quick to add that at times some false cases of lynching have been registered against people. Underlining that development is not possible without unity in the country, he stressed that the basis of unity should be nationalism and the glory of ancestors, and that the only solution to the Hindu-Muslim conflict is dialogue and not discord. While beginning his speech, Bhagwat said that he was attending the event neither for an image makeover nor for vote bank politics. You are listening to Three Things by The Indian Express. Today's show was written and produced by me, Shashank Bhargav, and was edited and mixed by Suresh Pawar. If you like the show, then do subscribe to us wherever you get your podcasts. You can also recommend the show to someone you think will like it. Share it with a friend or someone in your family. It's the best way for people to get to know about us. You can tweet us at Express Podcasts and write to us at podcasts@indianexpress.com.